has really forced a lot of people to adjust to a new normal, which is what we are doing. But as far as a brand is concerned, you know, sponsoring either a tournament like this or being associated with a team that's participating or a franchise that's participating in the tournament, when you have the kind of developments that have happened in the last 48 odd hours, where teams can get stricken by this pandemic as well, you can have the team being affected by it. How does a brand view it? What's the approach there?
Like I said, this year is more about empathy. I think of just challenging and questioning, oh my God, my money is involved, and getting nervous about it is not the solution. It's saying we walk together. This is a journey we all have to. I think despite social distancing, we are coming together as a team. So we are distant yet not distant, because we are working as a team together. We wish good health for all the players, and rather for everyone in the world. So it's about empathy, it's about understanding, and I think we've learned our so-called unprecedented plans to change and, you know, unprecedented times because of COVID, that April was totally empty, there was no work. So like, okay, we learned it. Now we've learned it. So I think if any more surprises will come, we'll be much more empathetic and resilient to work around that. So that's what I think everyone has learned, if I may say so, during these times. And that's where one of the learnings for everyone, I think, that be ready. I mean, future is unpredictable.
The future is unpredictable. And I think we'll underline that statement. I'm going to get Ankur's thoughts on this. Generally, when you have a tournament like an IPL or a very popular league that, you know, that conducts its games or matches, you have a whole lot of action happening on a city level where the franchisee is based out of, and there's a whole lot of promotion that happens. There'll be activities around the team's matches, not just the match in itself, but you'll have the, you know, events like a meet and greet, you know, the player promotion happening, certain brands getting associated purely for specific events. What's going to happen now, Ankur? Your thoughts on how things have changed there?
Raman, I think we as a race have a way to figure out solutions. So all of us have figured out solutions. Instead of being in a live room, we are all on a Zoom call and we're conducting a perfectly good panel discussion, right? So brands, agencies will figure out solutions, yeah? I mean, like I said, just to summarize a few things that I heard, which I really agreed with. Number one is IPL is a huge feel-good factor. All of us today need to feel good. We all need to see the ray of hope. We all need to see positive things happening around us. There is so much doom and gloom happening that each one of us needs to feel good. Second is that because of people being at home, the viewership is going to break all records. I believe that the viewership is going to be, it's going to surpass all records of the previous years. And the third and very important point is that honestly, there is a lack of other good options available for brands to spend. Earlier, they had a huge bouquet of options. If this doesn't work out, they've got plan B and plan C and plan D. Today, this is the only plan, right? There is very little for them to talk about. There's very little for them to do stuff around. So they will find solutions, whether it's digital, on-ground, activation, whatever. I mean, there will be interesting ways of doing those activations. All those things will happen because of these three factors. Feel good, huge increase in viewership, and lack of other options.
Well, yeah.
So I'm optimistic.
Yes, so, we need to. Nikhil, go ahead.
Absolutely, you know, even what Ankur said and Kamal, like, you know, everybody's waiting. I guess IPL will bring the happy hawa in the country.
You hit that. Perfect timing on that, Nikhil, as always.
Bhai, khiladiyon, timing bahut zaruri hai.
Bilkul, absolutely. Wo kala nahi jaati hai. You know, from a प्लेयर पर्सपेक्टिव आप हमेशा कैलकुलेट कर रहे होते हैं दिमाग में कि क्या रन रेट है, रिक्वायर्ड रन रेट क्या है, कितनी विकेट और रिसोर्सेज दिमाग में चल रही होती है, कैलकुलेशन पूरी चल रही है. फ्रॉम अ मीडिया एजेंसी वो भी कैलकुलेशन चल रही होती है कि इन टर्म्स ऑफ नंबर्स हाउ डू यू क्रंच दोज नंबर्स टू मेक इट वर्थ द वाइल फॉर अ ब्रांड, कैलकुलेट द रिटर्न ऑन इन्वेस्टमेंट. सो आई एम गोना जस्ट directed Mohit and Anita's way. Mohit, would you like to take a lead? ROI for a brand or for marketers here?
Okay. So, you know, while classically IPL has been a reach impact medium, right? And obviously ROI is always evaluated using econometric models and all. But this year, given the situation, every client wants to know what is going to be the return on that 1 rupee that I'm going to spend on IPL. So, you know, and rightfully so, given the situation. So the challenge on us as their media partners becomes so much more, because on one hand, we are not sure what are the challenges that are going to happen from now till the time the IPL starts, because, you know, there could be challenges, while I'm also very, very hopeful and very positive that it will happen. But again, there are certain things which are not in anybody's hand. Last 48 hours, we've seen certain new developments happening. On top of that, the client is saying, see, it's a very, very difficult year for me. You've convinced me to spend X crores. Now, ensure that it delivers. So that's a very, very, you know, I can see Komal smiling, but that's how, and that's what has to happen this year. Ensure it delivers. That's what the client said. And we have to ensure that it delivers. And that's where, you know, where Vanita and me will start crunching our numbers and creating decks for our clients. See, this is how the TVRs will look like. This is how the reach will happen. This is how the number of times the brand will engagement will happen. So it is our responsibility as their partners to go back to them with a hopeful, positive solution. Because end of the day, we are all selling hope, right? Otherwise, there is a hopeless situation which we have been in for the last 6 months. This is the first big hopeful event that's happening. And it is in our interest to go churn the numbers in the right manner and give them a very realistic view of what they are expecting. And then, as partners, I'm sure they are ready to take that risk along with us, because finally, nothing is as unclear as it. You know, this year is all about unclarity and you know, things not being in your control. So we are doing our best as partners, and we are actually going to all clients and telling them that this is, who have not ever been on IPL. We are even going to them and telling them this is one very big opportunity. It's happening at the time, right time, when you were anyway wanting to spend during the festive season. Why don't you look at options? So, you know, our job has actually increased tenfold, but we are enjoying it because it's for a good cause.
Yeah, I'd like to add that, you know, no risk, like you said, no risk, no pain, no gain. So that's how it works. And I think we all know how IPL works. I don't think we can ever build it through a traditional ROI metric or, you know, a media TVR number, etc. It is something much more than, you know, like we said, it's not just a media property. It's something really different. So, yeah, numbers are one side of looking at it. But I think the whole qualitative feel of the whole, you know, the brand IPL, is what lends itself that credibility, and that's why brands come to it. Having said that, I think we brought up a question of other options not being there. In this festive, there are some good properties on general entertainment channels as well. But I think then, like Komal was saying, it's interesting to see that she's talking about FMCGs coming there, because FMCGs usually prefer general entertainment channels. So you have KBC and Big Boss both coming out around the same time as, you know, during that period. So, yeah. Just wanted to highlight that. So ROI measurement, if you're talking about numbers, you can, you need not be very sure about, it's not very easy to prove it.
But you know, one thing I've seen, IPL never, fall short of surprises. So every year we've seen,
absolutely,
numbers will happen, you know, once it starts. So there will be surprises, there will be, you know, ups and downs. But finally, when you look at the post-evaluation, as we see it in the media agencies, you know, you will be happy that the numbers would have delivered, given the ups and downs. So it's a tried and tested property, and which is why, you know, you have so many takers for it.
And I think brands who've experienced IPL swear by it, usually, because it does work in the market, leave aside just media numbers. It's also about,
absolutely,
that.
There are two things. One, they say hindsight's always 2020, and when you're talking about a league that's galvanized 2020, then yeah, I think you know, the stand of people who've associated with the league has been vindicated. The other thing is, chaos always signals the emergence of a new order.
Yeah.
Is this chaos going to, you know, signal the emergence of a new order or a new path for brands or marketers to follow? You know, given the different tastes of people?
I would definitely say yes. I mean, I think, like I said, I as far as a consumer, if I have to see, it's more about now seeing brand in more, you know, you would want brands to see consumers more empathetically than seeing as someone, you know, you want to just sell your product, because there's a lot of need-based new normalcy that has settled in. Now people have moved from need-based products, they have moved towards, you know, connecting through digital platforms. So there are loads of changes which one has to practice now. Having said that, it's purely more empathy, more towards being sensitive when you talk about associating with any of the association, penetrating and reaching out to your consumers. It's all about now sensitivity that would play a role. So it's not like how you could go in the market, look for options, go and sell it out there, but you have to go and look for the right platform, be very sensitive with your limited budgets, and you know, adapt to the new way of reaching out to people.
Would brands or even media agencies look closer within to see what was being done by people, or what is being done during these COVID times, and see what is the brand or what is the connect that a consumer has with a particular service or a brand or an offering, and maybe that's what needs to be pushed. Is an open-ended thought. I'll come back to it, because there's a linked thought to this, which is going to go Nikhil's way. You've got Nikhil, a live sporting event like the IPL, and who do you have as a title sponsor? It's an e-sport company. You've got a Dream 11. That's the title sponsor. Is that also signaling a rising popularity of e-sport or people trying to play online?
Without a doubt. It's just like what everybody's been talking about, you know, with the IPL, the ROI. Now with Dream 11 being there, the e-sport, they're engaging people to try and play more, because this is going to be a global platform. The spectacle is so large, the IPL is the most popular league, that their reach is beyond. It goes from all over the world. So that is why they got this opportunity, and obviously at a bargain. That's why they grabbed this opportunity, and they said, we want to be associated with IPL, because the eyeballs, I personally feel, we've been associated with the IPL for so many years. Raman, I feel this year the eyeballs of the IPL are going to be phenomenal, because, you've got everybody who loves the game, but people who didn't even love the game will still want to watch the IPL a little more, because there's something on TV that would bring a smile to their face. So I think the eyeballs this time around are going to be much, much more in comparison to the earlier IPLs.
And Raman, as far as ROIs are concerned also, I think I must congratulate all the media agencies also working with the organizers and the franchisees. They've come up with the beautiful ideas of virtual platforms. So there's a lot of you have match toss opportunity. You can see the match toss earlier, the representative, which is on ground deliverable, and you get your performers to do that. You be there as a representative. You see a match toss mat of the brand logo itself. So if the viewership is high, you get to see that. There is virtual meet and greet, which Ankur also mentioned with your solutions. Like, we are there together. Distancing ourselves, but this is the way which virtual meet and greet is happening. So brands get to make their consumers to meet the players sitting at home in a zone and talk and interact with them. So there are new ways that have come up to solutions, I would say, for the new normalcy and maintaining distance and yet enjoying Zoom.
Yeah. I appreciate what you're saying, that the fact that we find solutions. The problem in itself is forcing us to find solutions, which at times turn out to be more feasible in the current scenario. Ankur, I'll go back to that point of e-sport, because is it also signaling a rise of another silent power? There's for a lot of time, there's been focus that's been put on live sporting leagues and their growth across the country, but under the radar, it's something like below the line kind of growth that's happened with esports across this Indian landscape.
So Raman, absolutely. I think what it's done is, this rise was anyways happening. It would have peaked around 2024 or 23. I had gone to Cologne in Germany 3 years ago to witness the world's largest esport event called Gamescom. And I was surprised. I'm sorry, I'm going out of context, but this city has a population of 5 lakhs and there were 10 lakh people to attend this e-sport event. It was crazy. And I knew that India is going in this direction. By 23 or 24, we would have some crazy e-sport events here and the craze. But this pandemic has just accelerated that. What needed to happen 3 years down the line will happen now 1 year down the line or 6 months down the line. So absolutely, this is the way, and esport companies are cashing in on it, and you know, it's unprecedented. What they've done is they've just accelerated that time period from 3 years to 6 months or a year.
Yeah, I'll kind of second that motion. I'll come to you, Mohit, because I'll talk about my personal experience. And this was last year in December. I hosted the largest gaming event in the country. It happened in Mumbai.
Nordwin.
Yeah, Nordwin was part of it.
Yes.
The event was called DreamHack. Yes. And I was surprised to see the kind of turnout that was there for a gaming event. There were, yes, of course, games for cricket and a whole lot more. But yeah, it just kind of opened my eyes to something that's not live sport, but
because it's always below the line, as you said, it's always understated. And now is when you will see it exploding. And with Dream 11 sponsoring, I mean, I don't need to say more.
Mohit, your thoughts on that? You wanted to add something?
Yeah, so I just wanted to add one more thing to it. You know, besides obviously e-gaming, the other sunrise category that has suddenly come up big time during the COVID is the education tech, edtech. And you see edtech also a part of the IPL. So today you have, an academy as well as the Byju's, some way or the other associated with IPL. So e-gaming is one very big shift that we have seen. As Ankur rightfully said, this pandemic is actually preponed it by two, three years. It was anyway happening. Same thing with edtech. EdTech was also going. Everybody sitting at home and education also happening from home. EdTech also as a category has become very, very relevant, and which is why you see their presence also in IPL. So IPL in a way is reflecting what the reality of the society is today, and which is what is being seen by presence of Dream 11, which is what is being seen by presence of an academy and all these categories. So just wanted to add to that.
You actually answered. Yeah, absolutely. You've just answered the question I'd thrown up a little while ago before I got into that esports in that people will tastes of people in these COVID times influence, which brand actually put forth their presence in the IPL. And I think that question in itself gets answered by your response there, Mohit. Taking that one thought further, what is it that brands will keep in mind? The brands associated with IPL, how would they like to leverage this tournament in this scenario? There are certain brands which have a long-standing association with the event. But given the changing times, and I'd like to get two perspectives. So I'm going to throw this to Vinita, and then I'm going to go back to Komal as well to get the two perspectives on it. Vinita, would you like to start on that?
Yeah, so brands would like I've already said, brands are also more bullish on television, and all of us are saying the same thing. So how can we maximize presence on TV would be one thing. And like Komal was mentioning, other ways of, virtual presence on television apart from just spots and being a sponsor, how else? And so there are a lot of other things that Star is willing to do and handhold and do a lot of other programming and out of the box stuff. And same with Hotstar. So they're also doing much more pre and post than earlier. So I think a lot of content, can be taken up, and that's what, and digital content is the way to go. So what advertising can't do, content can, is what they say. So I think content can be a good way to look at it. Of course, presence on television and developing your associations in your own unique way with their synergies. I think creative maximization is another thing we all know about. The more the brands like synergize creative around cricket, the better it really stands out. Yeah.
And Komal, would you like to add to that in terms of how a brand would look to leverage this property more? Someone who's been with this brand for a while?
So 7 years with Mumbai Indians. Yes, of course, I would like to add to what Vanita said that we are actually working on, creating contest on digital platforms to engage with our consumers, and having our trade partners or employee engagement through virtual meet and greet. It's a way where we are looking for solutions to, bring people together. Help them interact with their favorite players yet sitting at home. So there are new ways that we are looking at to, enjoy and make the most of it because it's not like sitting at home. And with brands like, you know, especially consumer durables, it's jo dikhta hai wo bikta hai. So we have to be seen at the right place at the right time. And what could be better than IPL?
Nikhil's nodding his head because player ke liye bhi wahi kahani hai, jo dikhta hai wo form play. You have to get the form on the pitch.
Sir, jo dikhta hai wo bikta hai, current mein hi current hai.
Of course, so stay relevant is what you're saying.
Yeah, absolutely. It makes a big difference. Like even Global Man, this I'm sure from their perspective, they picked Mumbai Indians. It's the team that follow has a lot of following. How you want to be associated with the team, or how you want to be associated with the IPL, with the kind of brand value you have, and who do you want to reach out to? I think that is very important. Yes, we have the marketing rules, but what I understand and what I see, you know, as one of the broadcasters, in the last so many years, there are so many different platforms, how the companies have been looking to market and, you know, join hands with the IPL, whether it's their presence in the ground. Now it'll be completely different, and like ma'am saying that we're looking to work on more content and how more brands could be associated. You might have longer duration of pre-game, post-game, and even that 2.5 minute strategic timeout as well. So there's a lot that you can attach yourself to as well. And with, you know, with these smartphones, it's not just television now. The smartphones, the reach has even got on to your rural villages of India where they're watching the games. So in terms of brand perspective, you're spending a rupee, is going all across. So it just depends where you want to place yourself.
I'll share a story. We were doing IPL commentary, and I finished my stint at the cab and was heading back to the hotel. And the guy who was driving the cab actually had the smartphone kept on the side, and he was watching the second match, which was still on. I said, keep your eyes on the road, buddy. Forget about watching what's happening on screen.
So that's what the smartphone has done. You know, it's brought your televisions to your hand.
We've seen rickshawalas do that as well. Auto guys also do that.
Yeah. Smartphones are the new screen. They're the new screen.
Like, but Raman, it's all about personalization and innovation. These are the two things that, you know, agencies will have to bring in for brands to really invest. They need to personalize content for the viewer, and they need to innovate. I mean, this is our test of innovation. How do we innovate when live audiences are not there? You've got content, you've got live action, but you need to reach out to the consumer in the most innovative way.
So engagement, a new way of engagement is what's being highlighted here. Vinita, would you like to from a broadcaster's perspective, and I'd like to get everyone's thought on this. The moment you're looking at longer programming, that's during non-match hours, the bigger the challenge to engage the audience to watch. There's of course the cricket action, which everybody does tune into, but the moment you're in an event like this where there's been a paucity of cricket or Indian cricket for so long, and the broadcaster then starts doing programming, how do you get those eyeballs for the non-match hours? Or, you know, is probably going to be another challenge. And how do brands and media agencies look at that?
Certainly, I think it is a challenge, but I think Star is working on it and they are doing things around it. But it is certainly a challenge, and especially so because there are other properties, like I mentioned, which are big ones also. So, you know, IPL typically, or any cricket, especially 2020, we all know does not have a dip in ratings of, you know, the match versus the ad break. But when there is content of pre-post, there are dips which are higher. You know, the viewership does dip higher than normal. And if that time if you don't have them, you know, glued to the television due to the content that they are keeping, it's very easy for them to flip to the other big things that are happening, because there is other big stuff that's happening on television. So it is a challenge. There's no doubt about it. But let's see. It's time to watch.
Nikhil, you've done some amazing shows with the broadcast, and there've been some very interesting shows as well. I think one big draw during an IPL is the dugout, which is generally, at times devoid of a lot of branding, sponsorships, or ad breaks, but it's very engaging for someone who's following the game. So just your thoughts on what could be an outlook there?
See, dugout, I think, is a brilliant, absolutely fantastic property that's been brought about, and it's innovative. It's, you know, you got guys who are explaining why a particular player is doing what he's doing, what is he thinking about, why is the, you know, quietest over in the IPL the over after the power play? That's, you know, it always goes for the least number of runs. So in terms of strategy, you're always looking to think ahead. And as a batsman, you're looking at, if I played say 15 balls and I haven't got say 10 runs, 12 runs, but if I'm a Rohit Sharma, I know that if I bat for a longer period of time, I'm going to, you know, wait for the bowling change. I need to hit two sixes to get back to a strike rate of 100. So you are looking to strategize. So sometimes who understands cricket, that is a very innovative way of engaging them as well, because every sentence, you're breaking down the strategy and you're actually a viewer sitting in your own house and saying, well, I'm getting to probably listen to what the player at this moment in time is thinking while he's playing live action. So that's one aspect of that dugout as well. Plus pre-game, post-game, I personally feel you have to, you know, your players reading about the pitch report and how you can engage. I've always been a big advocate saying that if you get many more people to talk in that pre-game as well, you want to see many more faces. Like ma'am says, like, this is the time where, say, Mumbai Indians, you know, it hasn't happened in the past, that after the toss also, Rohit can come out and just maybe speak a little bit about the strategy. If he's playing against Mahendra Singh Dhoni, what his strategy would be. It just makes that whole initial pre-game more interesting, because the viewer at that moment in time gets a glimpse of the two stars that are going to be in action and what will their perspective or thought process be in that game as well.
You know, from a viewer's perspective, and someone who's been on both sides of the you know, of the table, I'll get everyone's thoughts on this. It's also about wanting to see what's going on behind the scenes in the dressing room or in the dugout. Like Mumbai Indians, I know there's a you know, a statue of Ganpati that's actually placed in that on the table right next to the dugout, because I was the first season, I was right there and I could actually see. So they have these rituals that teams follow, which are very, very interesting. So someone who's been behind the scenes knows about it, but someone who's watching it as a viewer would love to see it. And that also becomes a, you know, a great segment that presents itself for branding opportunities as well.
I think most important, if I may, Raman, I think Vinita ma'am, Mohit and Komal and Akul, I think the viewer, if they want to keep engaged for a long period of time, are looking for stories. What is the story engaged with that team? What is the story with that player? You know, they want to hear, how did he make it there? Now once he's there, what is he doing at this moment in time? I personally feel that this time around, I know these are unprecedented times, but even how the teams are going to travel in buses, that in itself is a story. Once they reach the ground, what is their ritual? They wash the hands. What happens to the clothes straight after the game? You know, sweat. Like the ICC's come up with the ruling, no saliva on the cricket ball. How are we going to shine the cricket ball? Are the batsmen going to get more runs? So every little story you develop and tell the viewer, that is going to be an engagement to your viewer while watching the game.
Stories to be told. And brands...
That's why you're a storyteller.
And brands who want their stories to be told as well. Akul, just quickly thought, because I think...
Beautifully said, Nikhil. I think stories is what sells. And that's what consumers want. And that is where one creates the content to push across multiple mediums. So I think that was a lovely thought by Nikhil.
That's why I said IPL hava badal degi. Happy hava.
Happy hava.
Happy hava. And I'm wearing blue. So yeah.
So I think we've just got a very little time left on the slot that was given to us. So I'd request all the esteemed panelists to share a synopsis of what we look at over the say, 3 weeks as a build-up tournament and those 8 weeks of the tournament. What could be the takeaways to that? Komal, we'll start with you, and then I'll just go randomly across my screen.
Sure. So as a brand, we are looking for an exciting IPL, and like I would definitely say, as a brand plus for our consumers, we are looking for something moving from gloom doom to boom bloom, and have fun, have loads of good time watching cricket and engaging with our consumers on virtual and digital platform. We are planning good content and interaction with our players to know what is happening behind the scenes, like you rightly said, Raman. So this is what the whole innovative idea is, to reach out to our consumers and bring some happiness and joy there.
Raman, very quickly, like, just want to add on to that. Like ma'am said, samay simit hai, usi ki keemat hai. we are going to be taking time of someone's life to get them to watch an IPL game, we need to give that value to them as well.
Yeah.
That's the ROI.
That's the ROI.
Time, not the money spent, but the time you give to it.
Because wahi to seemit hai.
Super thought, Nikhil. That's probably, you hit the nail on the head. Mohit, very quickly summing up thoughts before we go to Vanita.
Yeah, so I'm hoping that everything goes well and there are no more infections that come across, and we have a fantastic IPL season, which will help us elevate the mood of this country, as well as get some very good advertising on television. So, you know, that's what I am hoping for.
A lot of times when you're talking about stories, they are not just stories of success or things being hunky-dory. It's about stories of emerging triumphant after the challenges, showcasing that the trials and tribulations that you've gone through before you've emerged victorious or successful. Vinita, could this be the story of IPL 2020?
Absolutely, bang on. You said it. No one could say it better. Yeah, I truly believe in our lives also as human beings. I believe in that from a spiritual angle, that unless you battle, you're not a warrior, right? I mean, you can't be called a brave soldier unless you go in the war. So it's like that. So out of these testing times, I'm sure there's much, much more that's, looking positive at the other end. So extremely bullish, like I said earlier, given the pent-up demand, given the festive season, given the whole IPL fervor that we all enjoy, like we actually plan our calendars, like Mohit was saying. A little less confident on the mass reach of Hotstar, like I already said. And as regards ROI, I don't think IPL needs ROI. IPL says, you know, I mean, from a very qualitative angle besides numbers. But yeah, so broadly these three things, I think, sum it up.
You know, you could be a king and you could be a warrior king. You fight the battle and you're known as the warrior king, as Vinita was saying. Ankur, parting thoughts from you very quickly.
Resilience. This IPL is all about resilience. We are showing that we can be down but not out. I believe it's all about optimism. It's about all about the feel-good factor. This is the way of things to come. This is the coming back of it. And I believe that this is what will signal happy days to our economy. It'll be full of surprises. It'll be high on engagement. And it'll be all about resilience.
IPL has always been that path breaker. Look back 13 years and the story is there to be told. There are many more, chapters to be added to this story. But I'll just wrap up this session with a little anecdote of my own. There was a person known to me when I was much younger. And if at all you weren't able to watch the match and you turned around and asked him the score, so he used to say, all out for no loss. And it used to completely leave you stumped. But I'm just turning that line around, all out for no loss, that it could be all out for COVID and no loss for IPL and everyone involved with it. That's what I'm hoping for. Panelists, thank you very much for joining in. It's been an absolute pleasure and honor to talk to all of you. A big thank you to Ankur, Komal, Mohit, Nikhil, and of course, Vinita. Thanks so much.
Thank you.